musicians themselves. This is The Writer's Block with music journalist David Fricke, exclusively on The Spectrum.
I was raised up by my mom alone. Worked herself into the grave trying to make us a home. She never left South Carolina. Oh, no. My old man didn't stick around to see me groan. He was long gone before the coffee got cold. Couldn't even know where to find him.
A song that feels very right for now, strong enough. Ray Lamontagne saying something I think we'd all like to feel right now, strong enough to get through everything that's going on around us, from his new album, Monovision, opening this actually very special edition of The Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum. I'm David Fricke. Very special because I have the singer and the composer right here on the show, Ray Lamontagne. Thanks very much for joining me. And before I get into anything else, congratulations on a record that I think it's very, very special and really speaks to now in ways that I'm assuming you could not have imagined.
Well, thank you, David. Thanks for having me. But yes, to answer your question, no, so much has changed so quickly. So much has happened so quickly. And, you know, this record was all but finished. You know, and then everything just flipped, just turned upside down, you know.
Could you hear as things were unraveling? I think that's actually really the best way to put it. Could you actually hear aspects of the songs reverberating in that? I look at just some of the titles and Strong Enough and, you know, Morning Comes Like Diamonds, which is something we'd really like to see. Happen. They're just these little echoes that sort of make you feel a little better, but also underscore what's at risk.
Well, I often think about songwriting, at least as it relates to myself, that when the songs are coming, I never sit down with the intention to write. It's just when they start knocking, I give them time. You know, it's like I just know that that they need some attention, that they want to play. It's time to play. It's time for my inner child to play. And this took me years to come to terms with the process of writing. And this is where it is now. And it's been this way for 10 years or so. And it works for me. So what happens is I'll finish a record and then months later we'll be mixing or something. And I'll listen and just think, oh, I think I'm starting to figure out what this is trying to say or what this part of me is trying to say. Because when it's happening, I don't question it. I just follow it, you know.
You worked, you know, regular gigs, you had regular jobs, and then the story goes, you heard a Stephen Stills song one morning, I guess, on your clock radio, and it was like your life changed. You actually took the kind of step that a lot of people dream of and aspire to, but maybe they don't have the confidence. Maybe there's a little fear going on, or they worry that, you know, they take that step, they're going to fall off a cliff. And you took the step and it actually became your life. You became a singer, songwriter, musician.
Well, it was far more gradual than that, I have to say.
There were more steps involved.
It sounds very romantic, but it was very, very, very gradual. And there are even moments now when I think, how did I get here? You know, because between that time of hearing something that really struck me in a deep way and maybe sort of kicked the door open just a crack to something, a place I didn't know existed or feelings I didn't know I even had. Between then and, you know, going to LA for the first time to sing songs for a publisher, I got married and had two children, you know, two boys who are now as old as I was when I got married. They're in their 20s now, you know? And so there was, you know, a good 8 years of, you know, between then and, as I say, sitting in front of, you know, the guys at Chrysalis Music and singing my songs for them.
But even with 8 years, you stuck with it in a way that many people, you know, they probably might not have had the constitution or the will or the desire to keep going. In some ways, the longer it takes, that's really how, you know, that's the thinning of the herd.
Well,
does that give you any sense of accomplishment?
Well, no, I do. I do feel accomplishment for sure. And I know, and the hard work, believe me, I feel it. I still feel it. But so much of that hard work was also tied into the fact that, you know, I was working 2, sometimes 3 jobs, and we were raising 2 boys off the grid and homeschooling while my wife is trying to build a career as a writer. She's a poet. You know, now she has 4 books published and working on a 5th. But then, you know, we were just kids. And I was, like I say, I was working as a carpenter, and then we were living off the grid. So there was all that work involved too, of just everything that that entails. I mean, we hauled our water from a dug well, we heated with a wood stove, and we took baths in a 2-foot galvanized tub. You know, we would get the boys in there, and then I would strip down and I'd climb in and the boys would scrub me, you know. And then, you know, and there was so much work involved that writing songs was always the last thing. It was something I did at the end of the day, late. I didn't want to wake the boys up, so I would quietly work on songs. But there was no intent. That's the thing. I didn't have any intent that it would ever be a career. I mean, that didn't even enter my mind. And I say that honestly, it didn't even enter my mind. It wasn't I didn't listen to Dylan and think, oh, I want to do that someday. I'm going to do that. Are you kidding? It didn't even occur to me. But I started to write, and it was good for me to do that. And I found that I loved, you know, I was starting to mess with melodies and build melodies and songs. And it just felt like something I was supposed to be doing. But there was no intention. There was no end game. It was just, I was just doing it.
Well, it's actually perfect that you mentioned Dylan, because one of the things I didn't mention at the top of the show is that Ray has essentially picked all of the music that we're going to play on this edition of the Writer's Block devoted to him, Ray Lamontagne, and the new album Monovision. And one of the things about Monovision, and we'll get to this a little bit later, is that you essentially, as it says on the cover, you produced, engineered, wrote, and performed everything yourself. And the song that we're about to play is something you picked from Bob Dylan's very late 1967 album, John Wesley Harding, As I Went Out One Morning. And I've got the album right here, and I look at the credits for this thing, and Dylan plays everything except bass, drums, and a little bit of steel guitar, which was Pete Drake, the great pedal steel guitar player in Nashville. And in actually listening to this song and going back to your record, that simplicity is, there's a bit of a relationship there between that record and what you seem to have aspired to on Monovision.
There is. And I'll tell you, I mean, I'm just going to describe this to you because that's a good point you make. Because when these songs started to shape up, right, I started to get an idea of what they wanted to be, what the batch of tunes was going to be. And it all happens quickly. So once I get started, once I hear the knocking and I know, I got to let the kid in. He wants to play. It's time to play. So I set the studio up and I start playing and I start going through my melodies, and the songs that come, you know, rise to the surface are the ones that get finished, and it happens really fast. So as it's happening, I'm starting to get ideas about what's going to surround them, what should surround them, what kind of colors do you want to put in there, you know? And it became pretty clear that the focus really wanted to be on the song, that there was just that kind of, they were those kind of songs, that each one stood on their own. So the focus really just needed to be the vocal and the lyric, right? The song itself, I guess, is just the core. And if you think of, you know, in like an old 40s movie, you'll see a shot of the hero and it's crystal clear because you want to see all his chiseled features, right? You want to see how handsome he is and strong he is. And then as soon as they shift over to the heroine, it's all soft. Everything in the background is all soft, right? To the ends of her hair, all soft. Her collars, all soft. All you see, all that's in focus is just the oval of her face, just that beautiful face. Because they want to take that image, they want you to focus just on how beautiful she is, right? So you can do that with a stereo image too. You can just take all the stuff on the periphery and just soften it a little bit and tuck things away. You'll hear that on John Wesley Harding. You're going to hear Kenny Buttrey's drums are way panned hard to the right or left. And, you know, everything's hard panned. And they did that in a lot, late 50s and 60s. You know, a lot of the Beatles records are like that. A lot of hard panning going on. And that's because the focus wants to get drawn to the vocal and the song, right? Just the core. It's not that it's, you know, there's anything... they don't want you to hear, they don't want, you know, you need to hear the foundational things, but it just needs to be soft, you know.
Well, we will have more from Ray about the process of making Monovision, writing the songs. We will have music from Monovision, but right now, here on the Writer's Block, I'm David Fricke with my very special guest, Ray Lamontagne, and he has chosen for you to hear this wonderful Bob Dylan song from 1967's John Wesley Harding, As I Went Out One Morning. From 1971, actually, to be specific, January 19th of 1971 at Massey Hall in Toronto, Canada, Neil Young, the final song of a very turning point show that he played in Canada, his home country, in 71. I Am a Child, actually originally recorded with the Buffalo Springfield in 1968. And before that, here on the Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum, I'm David Fricke, Bob Dylan, As I Went Out One Morning from 1967's John Wesley Harding. Both of those songs chosen for you by my special guest, Ray Lamontagne. He is here with me on the Writer's Block. He has brought along music from the new album, Monovision. And before we get to the new album, you picked Neil, I Am a Child. I took the liberty of picking that live version, but what was it about that song that just made you want to play it on the radio? It is a beauty, and I think that solo acoustic focus, again, connects a lot to what you tried to do with Monovision.
Well, it is beautiful, and when I heard it, of course, I heard it on the Springfield record, Buffalo Springfield record, and what struck me about it when I first heard it was just how much room he leaves to engage your imagination in his lyrics. His melodies take really interesting little turns, unexpected little turns. And his lyrics do the same thing. They can be really oblique, you know? And you can't do that intentionally, or it sounds intentional, you know? So there's something going on there that, for me, when I first heard it, it just immediately engages your imagination, you know? Because you can fill in the blanks. So you can try to see what it means to you, right? Not maybe so much to him, but he lets you into that world, and then you get to figure it out and fill in the blanks. It engages you know?
There's just enough open space in there, even just those opening lines, I am a child, I last a while. That second phrase doesn't actually mean anything literally, but it actually says a lot about there's a lot of road ahead. Then, as you say, you can fill in so many of your own blanks.
And it's playful. That's a key, is because he's writing it in a playful way, allowing that. See, this gets back to our critic, inner critic thing. So if you were writing that, maybe you would stop right there and say, well, what the hell does that mean? You know,
this is grammatically incorrect.
I have this. I can't use, what is that supposed to mean? It just rhymes. But you have to turn that critic off. That critic has no place in creativity, in creating. It's just like you're painting or you're drawing. Just do it and then figure it out later. You know, what does this mean? What is it telling me? I'm not sure. Maybe you never know, or maybe you find something in it, you know, but it takes a year to figure it out, or to figure, oh, this is what it means. That's those kind of, that sound, those songs, that engagement, that it asks you to engage in it actively. as a listener. That's the magic of music for me. These are the things that just, I was hooked, you know, I was just hooked.
Well, one of the things that really strikes me about Monovision and the whole title, it's very much, you know, it's not hermetic, because I think it's a very open and engaging and welcoming record and sound, but it is very much dependent on you making the decisions, you making the choices, literally putting the notes onto tape, as it were. And you have previously worked with a number of producers with good guidance instincts, like Dan Auerbach and Jim James from My Morning Jacket. What did you learn from them that really helped you figure out how to do it yourself?
Oh, boy. That's a difficult question, David, because, you know, I'm a very honest person, so I want to answer this honestly. I did not have a great time in the studio with Dan. There was very little just communication. There were other musicians around who I could talk to. And, you know, I met Seth Kaufman there, who's been on the last, you know, three records previous to this. He's become a really good friend of mine. Jim, working with Jim, you know, we co-produced that record. When I sent Jim, you know, I wanted to work with Jim because he was a friend. And I love the Jacket, and I love them as human beings. They're just good human beings, you know? But so working with Jim, it just, you know, that batch of tunes was a whole other thing, you know?
It seemed a lot more conceptual, you know, just the title, Ouroboros, I guess you pronounce it?
Yes, Ouroboros. And it was,
Ouroboros.
Sonically, it just needed to be treated so vastly different than Monovision, but it needed to be deep and dark. Everything needed to be dark. The sounds needed to be dark. The vocal needed to be dark. And things needed to be further away from you. And just the sonics, everything needed to be deep, you know? And when we were making that record, it was just, it worked really well because he understood where I was coming from. And he also is very welcoming in that, he knew that I had a really clear vision of what I was trying to achieve, but I didn't have, you know, I needed help to get it to where I wanted it to be. I sent him demos and he said, you should just use those, it's great. And I'm like, oh, no, it's not. You know, that's the map, that's just the roadmap. You know, this needs to be like four levels deeper. You know, we really have got to get in there and just do it. But as far as just making records, it's just that I pay attention a lot, that's all. I just pay attention. I like to see what they're doing with mics. I like to see what mics they're using. What mics bring out certain frequencies, mic placement. It's just fun. I'm mechanically inclined, and it just brings out that part of my brain. I just enjoy that, figuring out, you know, how to use the board, you know, and outboard gear if you need it or if you don't need it. And for the gearheads out there, I only used one single piece of outboard gear on the entire record. This record was straight through a tube console.
Wow.
So you get all of that beautiful, rich tube breakup on the vocal, not distortion, but just that little bit of color that a lot of modern producers don't want in there. That's wrong, right? And speaking of that, just any imperfections in modern records are wrong. There's such a, not everything, but in so many, the life is just compressed and crushed out of them.
It reminds me, actually, the British DJ John Peel had a great phrase, life has surface noise. And I've always believed that, you know, it's the imperfections that define humanity, not the lack thereof.
Yeah.
And it's funny, the song we're going to play next, and this is one of the songs that you picked from Monovision. I was listening to it again, and we are going to play some Van Morrison later, but the sort of strumming bed of guitar on this song, Misty Morning Rain, really did remind me of that very sort of almost gauzy strumming on Astral Weeks, very kind of quick and constant, almost like a bed of some kind under the vocal. So I, you know, it's a beautiful, beautiful setting for the song, but I couldn't help thinking of Astral Weeks just because of the way it works on that record as well.
Yeah, it's just a bed. It gives you a bed to build that melody around and to dance around it, which I guess we'll talk more about when Joni Mitchell comes around. But it gives you that bed, and then your vocal can just dance on top of it, you know, can just move around it.
Well, Joni Mitchell will come around in just a few minutes. But first, Ray Lamontagne, my guest here on the Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum. I'm David Fricke. The new album is Monovision. I highly recommend it. It is exactly what we need right now in terms of comfort, medicine, and inspiration. And this is one of the songs on that record, Misty Morning Rain, parentheses, Here and Gone Again.
Shadow on the wall, I can hear a kestrel call. Sunlight laughing, laughing through the window pane. All is here is gone again. Misty morning, misty morning, misty morning rain. All is gone, then here, then gone, then here, then gone again. Here and gone again. Here and gone again.
Actually, another song from 1971, Joni Mitchell's fourth studio album, Blue, All I Want, here on the Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum. I'm David Fricke. It's a special edition with my special guest, Ray Lamontagne, singer, songwriter, and producer, engineer of his own work. The album Monovision is out now. And just before Joni, we heard a track from Ray's album Monovision, Misty Morning Rain. You brought up Joni Mitchell a little while ago. Let's bring her up again. We don't need a whole lot of excuse to play Joni on this channel and this particular show, but what was your thinking behind All I Want, which is actually the first song on Blue? And I think it actually sets up the dynamic on that record. It's about really being together and the hard work, really, of being together. There's a lot of push and pull in those lyrics.
Yeah, and it's that album is an album that I don't know if I can imagine life without it. You know, it's just, I'm getting emotional.
You're getting verklempt.
I am. It's just, Joni hit me in such a way, and she still does.
Is it as
I just don't
lyrics
know
or?
It's everything. There's something more. That's the thing, is that it's, you know, you can listen to Bob Dylan and you see he's breaking the rules. He's breaking all the boundaries down, right? It's creative and
there's a restlessness to him that's very addicting.
It's different. And with Neil, you feel kind of the same. It's a very similar thing that drew me to Neil, is this engagement in your imagination, willingness to let go of all the rules and sort of deconstruct songs. And it's playful in that way. And then there's Joni, and it's something just so far beyond anything. It's just a direct emotional communication that is beyond what she's saying, beyond the melodies, beyond everything. It just goes straight into you.
But at the same time, it's interesting because, and I've talked to David Crosby a lot about this, her guitar chords, the rhythms that she plays, they're very eccentric. And it's interesting because All I Want, it's not even on guitar, it's dulcimer.
Right, yeah. And everything,
so you have that weird jangle in there.
But everything just dances around.
Her lyrics
dance around the melody. So she builds you like the foundation, and then she lays down her melody on top of that. But it's not even that way. It's almost indescribable what she does. It just everything flows and dances with each other. Every element is dancing. It's almost too much.
Well, when you've started writing songs, at one point very early on, you did like a demo record, some of your earliest songs before you got signed to RCA and made Trouble. What were those songs like? Like, how would you characterize your earliest writing as, you know, your first giant steps?
My first records, well, even just the songs on Trouble, I would say are really, I'm just wearing my influences on my sleeve, you know? I mean, I'm in school, and my influences are really heavy. You can really hear them, and it's a little heavy-handed, and in that way, that's what I hear. I'll tell you one thing I really hear, and it makes it difficult for me to even listen to those songs and even sing them a lot of times, is that there's a fight going on between the part of me that wants, that knows that I have to perform these songs to make them real, to make them live, and the part of me that doesn't want to. And there's a battle going on, and my voice is so, my vocals are so constricted and so tense, and not in a good way for a singer to sing that way. It's not good for you to sing that way. You have to be relaxed, and it's not relaxed. There's nothing relaxed about those first three records, I would say. They're very tense and very constricted. The vocals are very constricted. They don't sound very good. I'm not singing very well. And it's hard for me to listen to them. And I know by the third record or so, even the second record, I think I was beginning to learn that, you know, because I had been touring a lot. And I was beginning to learn, I can't sing like this every night. This isn't healthy. Something's not right. I need to relax somehow. It was really difficult for me to find that place.
Was it partly the experience of not just writing and doing it yourself, but then actually having to do it in front of people? Was there, I don't want to call it a fear factor, but was it?
It wasn't that. It was within myself. It was just within myself. It was like, there was, you know, I mean, I was a father. I had two boys, been married for, 7 years? You know, we had a life that was normal. It was just normal. And I was working towards apprenticing with a timber framer. I kind of had my life mapped out, you know? And then I was just writing songs for me. And then I started to see these folk guys coming through this little club, like a coffee house type thing, but they were making a few bucks. And I just started thinking, well, maybe I could make 20 bucks. I mean, if I made 20 bucks, that's gas money for the week, you know, that which is huge. I mean, that would have been literally a huge help, you know, for us. And that's what led me to do it, you know? And I can say I maybe played a dozen shows in front of people before I was signed to RCA.
Wow.
And I don't know, that's why I say I don't know how it happened, because it's just opportunities came up. Somebody heard something, gave it to a friend who heard something in it, who gave it to a friend. It ended up in someone's hands. It was an A&R guy. Next thing you know, I'm on the phone with him. And he just wants me to go out to LA and sing songs for them. And I'm thinking, what the hell's happening? Like I said, I didn't even know if I wanted to do it. It wasn't even, it just appeared in front of me, this opportunity. So I thought, well, maybe I'll just see what the opportunity take where it takes me. Maybe somebody wants to record a song I've written. Maybe you get 500 bucks, you know?
You were thinking maybe. Big.
I was like, maybe, you know, who knows? Yeah. I don't know. Maybe someone will buy a song or use a song.
That's what makes Monovision so interesting to me, is that in a way, it really circles back to your original impulses, which is doing it by yourself, and at least initially for yourself. You produced, engineered, wrote, performed everything on the record. There was no other voice. And in a sense, you've actually brought that whole cycle at least to a version of where you started.
Yes, maybe, I guess so. And yet, but where I am now, I don't, all I know is this, that the songs, the way it happens now, they just tell me what they want. That's all. So I never really know what's going to happen. I hear the knocking. I know it's time to sit down because it wants that creative part of me wants to play. And so I just let it happen.
When this particular song knocked on your door, I'm glad you opened up the door and let it in. This is actually one of my favorite songs on the new album, Monovision, Morning Comes Wearing Diamonds. And there's the sound of it. And I just like the sentiment in that line. And particularly at a time like this, when I get up in the morning, I'm trying to figure out, you know, how do I make this day better than the 100 or so that have just come and gone. And there's something very beautiful and heartening about this song.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you like it. And I'm glad you like the sound of it, because when I recorded that, it was probably 11th, God, it had to be close to midnight. And the shape had just kind of finally sort of, it was like a rough shape. I thought, that's a good rough shape. I need to get this down before I shut all the stuff off, or I shut the console down. So I just grabbed the first guitar that I had, which is a little bit funky. It's not my, you know, not the one I would normally go to. But I grabbed it and just played it because I just wanted to get the shape. And the next day when I came in, I turned everything on and wanted to listen to it again. Again, just remind myself, is this the shape work? Let's see. So I play it back and I'm thinking, yeah, the shape works, but I'm not hitting all my consonants and the guitar is, you know, I'm moving a little too much. So, you know, I'm getting a boxy sound out of the guitar from time to time because I'm moving too much. I'm feeling it too much, basically. I'm not paying attention. So I redid it. I re-recorded it with a different guitar. I paid attention to where I was, got a, you know, and then I listened to the next take. And I thought, ah, nice. I'm hitting all my consonants. Very crisp. Guitar sounds pristine. Perfect. And then that voice in my head says, what did you just say when you heard that? You said, your guitar sounds pristine. Your voice sounds nice, crisp. You hit your consonants. What is that? Listen to the first one again. Wow. I felt you feel the emotion of it. There's all kinds of imperfections, but the first hit, oh, that's the one.
Yeah.
So forget about the clean. You don't need, so forget it. I went and I just, a couple little colors around the edges, done. And that would never come out of Nashville like that. I'll tell you that right now. A song like that would never come out of Nashville because it's messy.
Yeah.
But that's what makes it live. That's what makes it breathe. That's what's going to, when you say that you like the sound of it, that I caught right on to that because I do too. Because there are things that it engages your imagination when you hear the guitar, like, wait, what's going on? What's there's little things that just, they make it live, like it's alive. It's not so sterile. It's like if you go outside and it's perfectly blue, perfectly clear, you look at it after, you know, 20 seconds, you're like, well, I've seen all I'm going to see. It's beautiful. And then you go back inside, you do whatever. But if you go out and there's, you know, there's dark clouds on this side and there's wispy clouds on this side and they're converging and things are moving, there's drama and there's movement and you could look at it for hours, right? Because there's just, you know.
What's life? You know, it's just, it's just life. Well, I would say this, if this is a mess, then I would say God bless this mess. This is a really wonderful performance, a beautiful song. And I'm really glad you picked it because I would have done it anyway. This is Ray Lamontagne, my guest here on the Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum. I'm David Fricke from the new album, Monovision. Sit back and just swim in this thing. Morning comes wearing diamonds.
The sun is shining, throwing gold through the windows to the floor. Hear a bird singing a song I never heard before. Morning comes wearing
taking it back to 1970 and a record that many people can't live without, including my guest here on the Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum. I'm David Fricke, the guest, Ray Lamontagne. His new album, Monovision, is out now. And we just heard one of the songs he has chosen for this edition of the Writer's Block, Van Morrison, Moondance, and It Stoned Me. I will ask the obvious. Why that song? I can pretty much tell that Van is quite the man for you, but was there something about this particular song that you just wanted to put that in rotation for us?
You know, I just, Well, like you said, I mean, that's just an album I love. I mean, to say I love it is just an understatement, but I love Van Morrison's work. I hold his work up so high, like Joni Mitchell. It's a direct communication that just transcends. It just transcends, you know?
It doesn't leave you a little speechless. Because in a sense, a lot of what he does is kind of take, you know, it's like he's trying to get the ineffable into the world. A lot of his singing is wordless. It's almost like he's channeling something from somewhere he doesn't know.
Yeah, it's so deep. And he's drawing from so deep within himself. And you can see that in all of his performances. That's very apparent. I mean, he's drawing from somewhere so deep. And I felt a connection to that and to him, but at the same time, in awe. And I still feel in awe because he's, you know, this is a spiritual thing. It's a spiritual person that you're witnessing, that you're listening to, with Joni, with Van. It's so much greater than the sum of its parts. I don't even know what else to say about it, you know, but he is, you know, that is a musician on another level. And
in your own work on this, particularly on Monovision, because it is a very solitary pursuit, as I keep saying, you produced, engineered, wrote, recorded. This is you, yourself, and, you know, no other hands on deck. Is it spiritual in the sense that you feel that you mentioned actually earlier that, you know, you're just letting these songs in. They come to you and say, essentially, give us life. Do you feel like you're channeling, not simply putting words and ideas together, that there's something beyond that's coming through? I don't want to get too super spiritual, but it is a spiritual act, the act of creation.
It is, and I think all humanity is born with that. I think everyone is born to be a creative expression of God. That's it. So we're meant to do it. We're meant to be creative in whatever way that is for you. At this point in my life, when it comes to working, I just get out of the way. I let them happen. I never know what's going to happen, and then they reveal themselves to me. It's just always a surprise that way. And as far as things like playing the drums and playing percussion and bass and then mixing everything and getting it the way you want, that's just part of choosing the colors. Like if you were painting, it was almost more a process. It was just momentum. I just found myself getting momentum and then lay down a bass track and I would hear it. You hear the bass track, you hear what you want for percussion, where you want to put the percussion, what color should it be? It's kind of technical, but not really. It's more just playful. It's really like just playing with a box of paints. And that's how this whole record felt to me. And then at the end, it was just kind of surprising. Like, oh, it's neat.
Well, you have you have a great discography. There is a lot for people to go back to. I highly recommend it. Ray LaMontagne, but Monovision, at least for me personally, it's a really special stop on whatever trip you're on. And I look forward to a lot more, but I intend to come back to this record quite a bit. I highly recommend it to everyone out there who listens to the show. This is The Writer's Block. I'm David Fricke on SiriusXM, The Spectrum. Ray LaMontagne, my guest, and we're going to go out with something that Ray picked as well. And it is by someone who has been pretty pivotal to him and just getting going in this calling. But you also pick something from a record that is very special to me, and we're talking about Stephen Stills, and it is the 1972 double album Manassas, a song called So Begins the Task. You've talked a lot about Stephen's song Treetop Flyer as being a real trigger for you just to even imagine doing what you do. What was it about Manassas, the album, and that song that made you go with that this time around?
Well, that's the part of the Treetop Flyer was the kick. You see, that was it was like a little hook that led me to Stephen. Do you see? I've tried to explain this in the past, but it wasn't necessarily that song or that recording, but it was something in what he was doing. I thought, who is that? What is that? And that led me to Crosby, Stills, Nash, Buffalo Springfield, you know, his solo records, and then Manassas, really. And so but that was the hook. That was what is that voice? Who is that? Stephen Stills, go to the record store, digging through, oh, Crosby, Stills, Nash, right. And then this. you know, and then, yeah. So, but Manassas, really, Manassas was and is to me still one of the best records. I think it's one of the finest records that's ever been made. That band is unbelievable. The musicianship on this album is unbelievable. It is mind-blowingly good. Yeah. The sound of the record is mind-blowingly good. His songs are incredible. It's just, it's like lightning in a bottle. That album is absolutely one of those things. It's lightning in a bottle. It will never happen again. It only happened once. And thank God that they got it. They got it on tape for us to hear, because it's stunning. And this song, So Begins the Task, has a moment in it that still gives me goosebumps every time. And it's like I fall in love with songwriting every time I hear this moment in this song. So Begins the Task. It starts, he gives you a verse, a chorus, second verse, and he's laying it down. Like he's giving you the melody by the way he's singing it, the way, you know, he's laying down this melody. It goes into Al Perkins' beautiful pedal steel solo, comes out with a chorus, and then into the third verse, and that's when it hits. He goes into that third verse, unlike the first two verses. He lays way, his vocal is so relaxed. He lays way back. It's like he just dances around it with his vocal. That whole verse, he's just, it gives me goosebumps every single time. You have to listen after the solo, chorus, and then that third verse, you'll hear it. He just lays way back on the beat. And it's, oh, it slays me. It just slays me every time. He's an amazing songwriter, an amazing singer, an amazing musician, really. But as he hit me in a different way as well, like a grounded thing. There's something grounded about his music. It's like of the earth. You know, Van is like from somewhere else, heavenly. You know, Joni is somewhere else, heavenly. And Stephen was like feet on the ground, earth, you know?
Have you actually, you had his daughter Jennifer sing with you on your first album, Trouble. Have you actually talked to Stephen and actually just let him know you're one of the reasons I do this?
Oh, yes, I have. Yeah, I met him several times and talked to him several times. And the last time I saw him was at the Greek. I was just about to go on, getting in the zone, and I hear banging on the door. Bang, 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 bang. Hard, not like knocking, banging, bang, 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 bang. I open the door, there's Stephen. How you doing? I'm proud of you, my boy. You know, he gives me this little pep talk before the show. It's great, it's great. And I've had moments like this with so many of my heroes. Emmylou Harris, I played this great festival in Canada. Emmylou stood side stage my whole set.
Wow.
After the show, she grabs me and gives me a big hug. She's very kind to me, you know. I ended the set with like Rock and Rollin' Radio, a song from Gossip in the Grain, and she just was so sweet about that song. And of course, I've met Dylan. I met Dylan and shared an interesting interaction with him. And again, he was so gracious.
Yeah.
And of course, Levon. Levon and I toured his last tour, and you know, towards the end of the tour, I was walking past his dressing room and he called me into his dressing room, calls me in. And we had a lovely conversation, which I won't share because it's personal, but just so gracious. Elvis Costello, of course, John Prine. I've shared the stage and time with these guys who I've, you know, idolize, you know.
And the thing is, you find that they have many of the same aspirations, needs, insecurities. Everybody's, you know, everyone who does this has some version of everything that you feel as well. And that, in a sense, that really makes you all part of the same, almost like a guild. It's a calling that you get to share with a lot of people that are very special to you, and at the same time share a lot of the emotions and accidents that you do.
Yeah, it's a trip.
That's a nice way to sum it up. Ray, thank you very, very much for being here on the Writer's Block. Mono Vision, please go out, hear it however you can. It's definitely good for what ails you. It's actually, I think, if not the best, certainly one of the best records Ray has ever made. Ray Lamontagne, Mono Vision, here on the Writer's Block, Sirius XM, The Spectrum. I'm David Fricke. Ray, thank you very much. I wish you peace, good health, and all the best when the smoke clears.
Thank you, David.